estas. We'll wing it. All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Window United Methodist Church, Church on the Farm. I sound really loud. Am I too loud? Need to turn down a little bit. It's hard to run the sound and test the sound and feel the sound. All good? All right. Wake up. Rise and shine. Today is the Lord's Day. We're glad that you joined us for worship today. Welcome. If you're joining us online, you can download your worship guide at windowumc.org. If you're with us today, you can pull up your phone, go to windowumc.org, scroll down to the PDF, and you can follow along with the prayers, with the songs, with the worship, and I hope you will sing along. We can hear whether you're singing or not up here, believe it or not, and we can see your mouths moving even behind the mask, so sing as part of worship. That's what we're talking about this sermon series. My name is Wallace. I'm glad to serve as your pastor here in this place. As we come to worship today, let us bow and for an invocation. Holy God, we give you thanks for the beauty of the day, for the way that your sun shines on us and the warmth of the sun warms us. Bless us today. In the chaos of our lives and the dullness of our lives, you meet us no matter what. And so we are here to meet with you today. Lord, bless us and bless our worship today through your Son's name, Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead so that we may stand and sing today. We pray. Amen and amen.
Join me for the call to worship. Our call to worship is from Psalm 89. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you.
I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations.
The heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too, in the assembly of the holy ones.
I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself.
As we join our voices together in an Easter affirmation of faith, might this be true for you as we voice it on our lips and in one voice. We believe in God the Father, who created the world, was faithful when we were not, and who continuously seeks to redeem the world. We believe in God the Son, Jesus Christ, who humbled himself by becoming human, was sent by the Father to give us life, embodied and taught the righteous love of God, and who, though he knew no sin, became sin and was put to death on a cross. We believe that 3 days later, Jesus Christ was raised from the dead by the power of God, was seen in bodily form by his disciples. We believe that the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus gives us victory over any form of sin and brokenness and allows us to know the full love of God for the world. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who actively works in our lives, giving us grace to be like Jesus and sends us to show God's love for the world. As people professing God's love in the world, we turn to a God who does love the world in prayer. And so I wonder if you have prayer requests, you can shout them out at me, and I'll listen as best I can as our tradition in the sanctuary to voice out prayer requests. I know we want to continue to pray for Renee as she lost her mother last week to COVID. Her mom lives in Africa. They celebrated her life virtually, which I'm sure was very hard. This past week, we pray for Renee. I continue to pray for Bob. Bob is planning to go home from his rehab at Wake Med on Tuesday. All things go well, so look forward to welcoming him home. We've had a couple of birthdays this week. One hanging out the sunroof back there, EK. Happy birthday! Everybody, look at EK hanging out the sunroof. Emmy had a birthday this week. Everybody, look at Emmy and embarrass her. Happy birthday, Emmy! Any other birthdays, anniversaries this week? Wave your hand like mad. No? Taylor had her birthday. Happy birthday, Taylor. Hey, everybody wave and embarrass Taylor. Any other prayer? To the what family?
Royal.
Royal. Thanks, Curtis. Condolences to the royal family, the king and queen. Yeah, thanks, Curtis. Anything else? You shout at me. Oh, pray for Fran's dad as he goes into assisted living this week. That's a big move. Yeah, bless him. Yes, continue healing for Shorty Jesse Amen as he's healing from knee surgery this past Monday. Doing all right?
Yeah,
doing fine. All right, well, let's pray. Lord, it is a good and right and joyful thing always and everywhere to offer our praise to you. Some days it's easier than others, but in all days we offer you our thanks and praise for the good life that you've blessed us with, for the beauty of the day, for the transition of the seasons, for the gift of resurrection, both in our lives and the hope of resurrection in the world to come. We thank you, Lord, if there is ever a time to pray for resurrection of our world. Lord, today is the day. As we mourn the loss of loved ones, as we lament the pain and evils of violence throughout the world, especially here in our own country, we pray that those in power would soften to your guidance, that we would be able to lead lives worthy of being called children of God. Lord, call us into this place. Lord, we thank you, though, for all the good things of our lives, for birthdays and for anniversaries and for new jobs and for new births and new marriages. Lord, this new season of spring gives us hope for the life to come, that this is not all that it is, but we have hope to come. Lord, until we are able to see resurrection in its fullest, we cling to the hope that you are moving in our midst, that you are calling us out of the grave of our sin and into the glorious light of your redemption. And until that day that we find it in the fullest, might we continue to pray the prayer that you taught us in one voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Church, a new song for us today is called Because He Lives. A new version of it, though, so I hope you'll follow along and sing with us that the reason that we are here in worship today is because Jesus Christ died on a cross but did not stay in the tomb, was resurrected, and because He lives, so we can live also. Rod, take it away, buddy.
Amen. Amen.
Church, would you join us in the scripture today from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 7, as we prepare to hear the word of God proclaimed. Might we pray together in one voice prayer for illumination. God, source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and minds may be opened. Amen.
Today's scripture, 1 John chapter 3, 1 through 7. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. Yet we do not know this. What we do not know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we see him as he is, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure.
Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous.
And church, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. All right, band, thank you for leading us today. Wow, that was awesome. So on the band, as they disperse, we got Scott on the drums, Rob on the guitar. Over here, we got Charlie on the bass. We got Becky on vocals. We got Mike Norton on vocals. We've got Gray Barnhill on vocals. And we have our fearless leader who selects the music every week and does a phenomenal job putting up with me and all involved, Lee Ann Thornton. Thank you for leading us in worship today. All right, let's see. So thank you for being here today. We're going to make this really awkward transition really smooth as I move the stands around and we move and give me front and center stage, right where all preachers like to be. So we're in the middle of a sermon series. We're calling Sing to the Lord a New Song. If you forget it and you drive by Wendell Falls, it's printed on the banner out here. If you forget it and drive by Main Street, it's printed on a sign out there. It's based on a song that says, "Sing to the Lord a new song." And so we're looking each week at hymns of faith that influence the ways that we can live into our faith as people, as children of God. Like, whatever you understand as worship music to you, like, no doubt worship music has always been a part of worship. All right, music has always been a part of worship. So whether it's Gregorian chants really gets you going, or whether it is like Bach cantatas that really soothe you and connect you to the spiritual music, whether it's like rock and roll band, or whether it's organ music blasted out of an 18th century organ, whether it is rock and roll, jazz, hip hop, Christian, whatever it is, like, music has always been a key part of worshiping together. And throughout the Old Testament, you see God's people always singing songs to God. Like, when the Israelites made it across the Red Sea, they sang songs. We have the Song of Songs, the Song of Solomon, a whole book of Psalms. Most of the Psalms written were to go to music. We see even through the whole New Testament, we have the canticles that are written. Like, the most famous is Mary's Magnificat. Remember, through all of the scriptures, we see songs. Even in the new church, Acts Church, the disciples were gathered together to pray and to eat and to sing hymns. So music has been influential and formative to our lives as Christians for a very long time. Even as Methodists, we have been known for people who sang more than any perhaps body else. It is in our DNA. So, and music, this is my theory. This is my theory. We're sort of playing this hypothesis out over these next few weeks. My theory is this: is music, Christian music, paints a picture, a broad picture of God's work in the world. All right, music paints a picture of God's work in the world. Good music, good Christian music, like thoughtfully written, puts us in that song. It puts we can, in a song we can find ourselves in God's overall picture. And so we're looking at each week a different hymn of faith, the ways that God paints the overall picture of faith in that, and we find our place in that. Today we're looking at one of the classics. Today we look at a hymn that paints a picture of God, of God's family and our place in that family. God's family and our place in that family. So when we think about family, right, no doubt our family names are important. Like, we could go around and all talk about our family names and the heritage they bring. Family names bring pride. They bring a sense of belonging. They bring a sense of who you are and like whose you are. Family names either bring pride. They may bring some shame. But there's something that comes with a family name, right? So my name is Johnson. Of course, I am a Johnson, but there are certain things that I have to do because I am a Johnson, right? Like, you all have them in your family as well. And it happens every year, well before COVID, but when everybody would be gathered around the Thanksgiving table or the Christmas table and the dishes are passed, and it would the one offensive moment would come every year. Somebody would have the audacity, would have the gall, would have the just unbelievable idea to pass on the collard greens, right? Usually it was a somebody dating to be, right? So I warned Ashley, like, Ashley, you got to just put some on your plate and sort of move them around and eat them if you want. Like, to not eat collard greens would, like, somebody would pass and then it would all, a hush would fall and everybody would look at that person. Like, to be a Johnson. There are certain things that come with that. It means I eat collard greens. It means I'm not afraid to get my hands dirty with some hard work. It means I pull for the right shade of blue, right? The right shade of blue. It means that I thank God for my food before I eat. It means on the 4th of July, I flag my American flag while I'm churning a churn of vanilla ice cream in my White Mountain churn. It means that I say prayers. It means that unless I'm in the hospital, I'm at church on Sunday morning. Like, to be a Johnson means all of these things. Some of my cousins don't eat collard greens, you know, and that's a story. And actually, I was very close to not being invited to Thanksgiving dinner when I took my acceptance to Duke Divinity. It was really, really serious. Like, to be a Johnson, like, I was almost disowned from that. Like, you have all those things in your family. The text today, John's writing, is dealing exactly with that issue. John is writing to this group of Christians. This group of Christians that say that have this wrong idea of what it means to live a life of faith. John says, you are children of God. This is your name. This is who you are. You are children of God. But it doesn't mean that you don't act like children. He said, you are not acting like children of God. So John is writing to this group of people called the Gnostics. If you look at it, it's got a G in front of it. It's G-N-O-S-T-I-C, the Gnostics. And the Gnostics had this really interesting idea, this idea that the mind and the body were totally separate. It's like it's a dualistic idea. And so it sounds really like sort of up in the air, ethereal, until it comes down to the ground. Like, the problem was these Gnostics, these Christians, were treating they were treating their bodies poorly. They were treating other people poorly. They were taking advantage of people. They were not respecting people, all because of this, right? Because the person was saved, because the person received grace, because the person professed Jesus Christ. It didn't matter what, I'm in the wrong spot. This is your spirit. If you profess Jesus Christ, it doesn't matter over here what happens to your body. There's a separation between body and spirit. And so John is writing and saying, this is not exactly right. Like, it matters. It matters deeply what you do with it. To be a child of God, it matters what you do. It matters what you do. And it was an issue all throughout. In 325, we see the Council of Nicaea. Anybody heard of the Nicene Creed? The Nicene Creed comes right out of this that John is talking about. It's this idea that the mind and the body are connected deeply. The mind, body, and spirit are connected deeply. We can't separate them. And so Council of Nicaea deems it heretical, fun word that only preachers get to use, heretical that you can say this. You know, people were put to death, people were beaten, and so suddenly we have that this is not okay. See, this was the rub with John's audience. This was the rub with the Gnostics, which continued that if God saved our soul, why does it matter what we do? If we have forgiveness of sins, why does it matter what we do? If we have grace, why does it matter what we do? We see throughout Scripture, John talks about this. The Gospels talk about this. Jesus talks about this. Paul talks about this, this connection of mind and body, that if we profess Jesus, it matters deeply what we do with our lives. And so though it was deemed heretical, the Christian church continued to deal with this issue of Gnosticism, of dualism, of this Aristotelian idea of separation of mind and body. Now, this is how we get to justify how we treat one another. So a long time later, we get this man, also named John, different John. And this man's name is John Newton. You may know the name. John Newton was the son of a wealthy merchant. See, John had a big last name. He had a last name that came with status and class and wealth and money. John's mom died when he was 11. He had nowhere to go, so he joined his dad at age 11 sailing these merchant ships. He, by all accounts, was a spoiled brat of a kid, right? Anybody know any only children spoiled brat? Don't raise your hand. Don't point fingers, but you all know them. He was a spoiled brat of a kid. He always got his way. He always got what he wanted. He never had no to him. And so as he got older, his dad gave him this really cush position in a merchant sailing ship. And you know what happened? The British Navy tagged him and said, nope, you're going to serve in a war on a naval ship. And so like all spoiled brats might struggle with Navy work, so did he. He was treated, quote, poorly, is what he said. And so he deserted. He deserted on the island, and he said, good riddance. And later on, he was found. He was beaten. He was sent to work as a slave. At this point, his dad had died. He was sent to work as a slave on a slaving ship, I think. And so over time, he had a terrible accident. He was cast overboard. His dad's friend found him. His dad's friend, remember the status place? His dad's friend had status. His dad's friend took him and said, you're built for better than this. This is not your family name. You're built for better than this. So what did he do? He sent him as a captain of a slaving ship. John Newton became quite wealthy, running merchant ships full of slaves across the Mediterranean for quite some time, until one day he was with an empty ship going back home. His ship's name, doesn't matter what the ship's name was, also I can't remember what it was going home. A big, terrible storm came upon them. He's coming up from the below the deck. He sees one of his friends, like, literally before his eyes, washed overboard, never seen again. He takes the helm of the ship at 22 years old, prays to God for the first time he had for a long time. His mama at 11, before his age, before she died, sang songs of faith to him and prayed to him. His mama taught him how to pray. He had not prayed probably for 10 years, and he comes at the ship and is praying, dear God, save us. I'll do anything. You've been there before. I will do anything if you save me from this. For 11 hours, he piloted that ship out, and God saved him. And so what did he do? He gave his life to Jesus. He started going to church. He started praying. He stopped swearing like a sailor. Like, it literally says that in his journal. He stopped swearing like a sailor. He kept running this slaving operation. See, this Gnosticistic idea, this separation between mind and body. In his time, the dominant culture was, this is a good thing. These people, these aborigines, are being saved. see this, saved. They are given Jesus, right? They're given opportunity to find this. They are being made civil, right? This is like, how could he give that up? Why would that even come into question? How could he give that up? And so this had been Edward's world for the past 20 years. And so he continued in it, this Christian child of God, taking people and enslaving them. This Gnosticistic idea that John is writing about, this Gnosticistic idea that this John Newton is dealing with, this is Gnosticistic idea that Christians throughout all history have really struggled with. This idea, like through the Crusades. You remember what the Crusades? Like these people are being conquered in Jesus' name. I'm going to murder you in Jesus' name if you don't profess. Like this separation of mind. Like Hitler. Hitler was, if you take Hitler's name out of it and read a story of his life, he looks like the better Christian than any of y'all sitting here. But there's a separation of mind and body. We're able, hold on to this, we're able so easily to justify our sin. And I think that the way that we justify it is this Gnosticistic idea. I've been saying that. I don't even know if that's a word. But we're going to make it a word. Gnosticistic idea that people are separated by mind, spirit, and body. And through Jesus' witness, he says, no, it's the same. It matters. It deeply matters how we treat one another. It matters. So over time, you know, what we would call sanctification in our world, John Newton became friends with some other big names you might know: George Whitefield, John Wesley, Will Wilberforce. In this time where the atrocities of slavery start to arise and people realize that these people being enslaved were actually human beings and not animals. That as this started to come to light, John went to college, he went to seminary, he became a pastor. He slowly, over a long period of time, over 10, 20 years, he started to let go of these grips that had a hold of him and was sent into a new life. And this new life dedicated himself to two things. One, it was the eradication of the slavery. The one thing that made him wealthy, the one thing that it meant to have the last name Newton, he was going to let go of. And number two, he was going to educate the world as his parish the atrocities of this work. And so John went preaching and teaching. He was sent out. He wouldn't be ordained because of his crazy ideas that slaves were actually people. So he found a place to preach and he took off. And see, this talk of Gnosticism, separation of mind and body, it might sound like it's something from another world, like something from 20 years ago or something even from the Bible that you had to deal with. But it has consequences here and now. It means very seriously, it matters how we treat ourselves. It matters very deeply how we treat one another. No, it challenges us to the very core. No, if we claim children of God, then we act as children of God. And it means very specific things. It challenges how we spend our money. It challenges how we spend our time. This idea of people, bodies matter. It challenges what we do with our resource. It challenges how we deal with and how we look at poor people. It challenges how we deal with and what we do with outsiders. It challenges what we do with and what we think about people on immigration and outsiders. It challenges what we do and think about sick people in our lives. It challenges what we think about mass incarceration and mass shootings and inappropriate treatment of people. Like, if we take this work of children of God seriously, then it matters very deeply. Our complicity and our actions in what we do. Like, as children of God, it matters what we do. Grace. Great. This is your tweetable quote for the day. Grace is not freedom to sin. It's freedom from sin. Grace is not freedom to do whatever it is we want to do with ourselves, with other people, but it is freedom from that. This idea of grace, that Jesus conquered the grave, that Jesus conquered sin. Yes, Jesus died for our sin, but Jesus died not so that we could continue sinning, but so that we could take a good hard look. You remember our Easter sermon? We could take a good hard look at our sin right there in front of Jesus and then go the other way. This is the work of resurrection. And so I wonder today, like, what are you justifying in your lives that you need to let go of? It's so easy to justify our personal sin. It's even easier to justify this idea of corporate sin. Sin that maybe happens on the TV screen or in government or even in the church. What are we justifying today that we might need to deal with as children of God? So, you know, one day, some 20 years later, after John at Newton had this coming to faith moment on the ship, 20 years later, he's now a pastor at a high steeple church. He's made it. He's very successful in his work. And he's working on a New Year's sermon. A New Year's sermon. He pins the words of one of the most familiar songs of our Christian faith. It was not given a tune at the time, but he is looking in his life. Remember the story of song. It paints a picture of God's work, and it puts us right in the middle. John says, how can we encapsulate the whole picture of God? And he writes one word, and he says, grace. And he backs up before that. He said, not just grace, amazing grace. Amazing grace has come to be the song of our faith in many ways. Now, it paints the picture of who God is and who we are as children of God, saved by grace, not to sin, but from sin, so we might have freedom from our hurts, our hang-ups, our habits, whatever it is that has us so buried in the grave. Amazing grace. Published in over 50 languages, been printed in thousands of different hymnals. You have all sung it at funerals. It was sung when the Berlin Wall came down. It was sung by the crowds when Nelson Mandela was released from prison. It was sung by singers, world leaders, presidents. It became the sort of the marching tune of the abolitionist movement. This tune, Amazing Grace, has been on the lips of hip-hop singers and country singers and bluegrass pickers and jazz improv musicians. It's been on the lips of those moms and dads late at night rocking sick children desperate for any sort of hope for to come. It's been on the lips of slaves praying for some sort of grace in their lives. It's been on your lips as you gathered around the deathbed of one of your loved ones, as maybe even a pastor said, let's sing together. Amazing Grace is the story of God's love for us, and it tells us our place in it. The Amazing Grace is our song because it's God's song. Paints the picture of God's presence in our lives and puts us right smack in the middle of it. On his deathbed, John Newton, a writer of Amazing Grace, he said this, "My memory fails me." He didn't know anybody. His memory had gone. "My memory fails me, but I know two things. I am a great sinner, and Jesus is a great Savior." I know two things. I am a great sinner, and Jesus is a great Savior. Jesus is a great Savior who comes down into our mess, into our addictions, into our hurts, our hang-ups, our habits, into our mess, and pulls us out of it. He doesn't just come down into the pit and say, I forgive you, and then leave, but he comes down into your mess and says, I forgive you, let's get out of this mess. That is amazing grace. But oh, the danger of amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For once I was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. You know the danger in that. The danger in being found, and the danger in being able to see. The danger in being found, and the danger in being able to see. Is that then you got to do something about it. Grace is not cheap. Bonhoeffer called cheap grace. Grace costs us our very lives. In fact, Jesus said, why don't you pick up your cross and follow me? That's grace. When we receive this grace, this amazing grace, our eyes are open and God finds us. We don't stay in that mess. But we're called out of it. The dangerous thing about amazing grace is that you will be found, and you will see, and you will have to do something about it. So, children of God, and we're all children of God, what are you justifying that you need to let go of? What is God opening your eyes to see, perhaps in this very moment, that you need to move away from? What is God opening your eyes to see that you maybe don't want to see, that you know you need to do something about? As we sing this last song, band, I hope you might pray the words that you're about to sing, that God would open your eyes to see. And that we might even do something about it. This in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, all who offer us this amazing grace. Amen.
Amazing grace.
Children of God, and you are, we are children of God. Matters very deeply what we do, how we treat one another. Sorry, y'all, it's not good enough to say bless your heart, but when we are saved and when we are have our eyes opened, it matters what we do. And so, let us go today. In the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, who offers us forgiveness, who pulls us out of our mess, who opens our eyes and sends us as Jesus Christ, hands and feet into the world, that all the world might know Jesus' saving grace. Might we go? Amen. Amen.
Love.